only things, it's things that live and interact. I'm repeating because I think it's a clear mantra, at least for us. If things are living, things are kind of becoming from objects to subjects. And it's, and substitute things with things that matter, and that include person, people, our own kids, our own babies, our own pets. Everything is connected because it matters. And this is our vision. At least this is the Telefonica IoT vision. We are in charge of creating and making possible for people to connect with the things that that matter to them, and make that the interconnection incredibly with a lot of more possibilities. Why? Because everything is happening somewhere. Everything, unless you talk about antimatter and things like that, dark matter, everything is happening somewhere. And life in IoT, we feel that it's everywhere. Even somewhere over the rainbow, something is happening there. So that's why we talk about the IoT scenarios, where the IoT things happen. This is our vision of the IoT scenarios. This is important because we understand that the IoT starts with the person. That's why we start with the things that are around me, things that things are talking about me. And the things I do affect my things, and that things can share a message to the rest of the scenarios. The scenario is expanded to my home, where I live, my family, my transport means, my vehicle, motorbike, buses, whatever. Where I go to shop, retail spaces, smart cities as the main, the whole domain on everything, and the digital life in it for the digital citizen. And of course, the production environments, offices, factories, work sites, mining, everything, and things that are moving from one scenario to another far, far away, like big ships in the ocean. Everything is connected, and again, these scenarios are not isolated. They are not static. They are not silos. They are moving because you can move, and you are affecting, and you are generating other interactions. You, your personal IoT scenario, you move around your home. You move, and you enter your car, and your car moves around the city, and it's affecting the city, and the city is affecting the car. I'm affecting my car because I'm entering my car. My car could be aware that I'm not been sleeping very well because of my wearable, so he can take some decisions about the temperature, the speed I can reach. Everything is connected, and everything about the our vision of the IoT is around the person and the different spheres where I interconnect and I interact. And everything and all this thing is based on several tech trends that we are going to review. This was an introduction about the vision, the scenarios, the IoT thing in our minds. And now I'm going to give you a few tips of things that we feel that we see that they are happening and they can make a difference in the IoT. Every IoT vision should be based more or less in these four layers: a physical layer with the asset, the devices, and the connectivity. It's quite elemental. The next thing is to be able to manage these assets, these interconnection, these devices. The third one is where the services, the IoT services, are built. The usual IoT platform, the usual services end to end for the IoT sphere. And finally, four layers, and the analytics. Okay, I'm going to have billions of collected things with data. It's cool to have this data and make a use of them and have benefit of them. Not only monetize, it's to have more benefit and enhance all the rest of the layers. So starting for the first layer, the physical assets. New connectivities. We are going to see, we are seeing that the LPWE technologies and all the evolution of the cellular technologies. What is LPWE? I assume that most of you know. Okay, the traditional networks, cellular networks, have been evolving, designed for human communication. So we are reaching a lot of bandwidth, blah, 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 low latency and everything, but maybe machines can have a different needs. That's why LPWE value proposition is to have a wide range, deep indoor coverage, lower cost, because as this is going to be massive, this has to be cheap, and reduce battery consumption. Things I want to have things for years in the middle of the field without going there to have to change the battery. Okay, you know that we have licensed spectrum technologies and licensed spectrum technologies, LTE and the evolution, narrowband IoT, and things like Sigfox, LoRa, Ingenu, and things like that. And they are covering a different space. They are covering a space with a lot of range in distance and a low bandwidth, because most of the things we think that they are not going to need a lot of bandwidth. Most of them, but some of them they are going to do it. And this is a simple classification for devices. We start with the things that are going to be very cheap. For example, narrowband IoT with a price point around $5 per the model of communications, and then low bandwidth that usually is okay for the use cases that we are going to cover. This is the massive sensors used to massive deployments, like walls, meteorologists, measuring, street lighting, parking control, and things like that. On top of that, we have the wearables that are okay. They are powerful enough to have a lot of funny functionalities, but they don't need a lot of bandwidth. It's enough to have around one megabit, and they are going to be around $6-$9 in the communication model. On top of that, we have category one. This is basically the mobile, the connected devices, mobiles. And on top of that, we have the top end of routers and high capacity devices. So LPWE use cases, right now we are working and we are seeing a lot of use cases on the agriculture and livestock. We have products like Cattle Watch, when you can have your cows monitorized and even that monitorized not only to know where they are, that is good, it's okay, but we can get that information to put in a big data algorithm and detect if some assets, in this case cows, are going to get ill or are going to get to have a disease. We are also working in, of course, in utilities, to have a large deployments of gas meters, of electric meters, with a lot of granularity of what's going on in that city, in that household. Logistics are also going to be a good use case for LPWE. You want to monitor big containers around the world. You don't want to have a lot of coverage. It's only a few tiny pieces of information from one point to another, and that's all. And okay, we have been talking about LPWE. That's the one of the evolution of the LTE, the cellular networks, and by the other, it's going to have a low bandwidth coverage, blah blah blah. But we also have another branch of another way of evolution for the LTE is with a high bandwidth, very low latencies and everything. That's the 5G. We are working. We are almost there with the 5G. 5G is going to enable what we call tactile internet. Tactile internet is where things happen just after you touch it. The latency is so small that you can almost feel that everything is happening at your fingertips. We are going to be able to have use cases like telecontrolling things that are kilometers, thousands of kilometers away, because the consistency, latency, and the quality of services of this technology is going to be so interesting that we are going to have these kinds of use cases. Sorry. We are going to have also critical surgeries and critical missions where low latency is especially important. We also, connectivity ecosystem makes no sense if you don't have a sensor ecosystem. So you have seen, we are working in the network, but we work hand-by-hand with the people from the chipset, the modules, communication modules and everything. We are working to have this kind of intelligent sensors to transform the experience in smart houses and even in the workplaces. We are going to have the explosion of the wearables. You know, it's not only to have a nice watch with your WhatsApp notifications. It's not about that. It's about having something that makes your life easier, that helps you at work with new ways to interact with the environment. We are going to talk about that a little bit later. And we are going to be able to have a smart textiles, smart clothes. So because they are going to have a tiny sensor that can make the cloth more to be, if it is cold, if it is hot, it can be more fresh. We are going to have that kind of intelligent clothes. I'm not going to talk about the second one, that basically is management, business and management. The third one is where the services, the products, and the are built. In this part, that layer about the IoT platform, we feel that there are two main concepts, the platform and the service, the public clouds, and things like that, and an open ecosystem to capture talent and to capture to capture innovation. About the IoT platform and service, okay, it's a no-brainer because it's about flexibility and scalability. So that's why and convenient. Right now we have agents, actors like Amazon or Microsoft with Azure that they offer a lot of templates about the architecture you should use to build your applications, your ecosystem, and of course they give you a lot of building blocks, a lot of tools to make very, very easy to put your ideas to work. The IoT platform and service is a huge enhancement in the ecosystem, and they give you a lot of tools, and you only have to make the ideas and make them real. And very important, they are evolving not only to be connection platforms. They are talking about data routing, how to make that data that they are talking about valuable and to be directed to the part of the application that is important. Another thing that we are working on is open ecosystem. It's our idea to capture the talent out there, to offer the tools to capture the talent out there. A lot of people that they are building an ecosystem, more or less open or more or less proprietary ecosystem, to make people easy to have new things developed quite easily. In the smart homes, wearable smart watches, in the industrial thing, connected car, drones, and augmented and virtual reality, we are putting the tools there to make people easy to work. Because there is a lot of people right out there, maybe some of them they are right here, working on this, developing with the talent and the idea, the passion to do it happen. In 2020, we are going to have more than 10 million people interested in this kind of developers. And 1 in 3, with a lot of them including and working in IoT. A lot of other agents are building this kind of open ecosystem. Again, Amazon with web services, Salesforce, Microsoft Azure, and even we, Telco Paredo, we are building that. Like Deutsche Telekom with their smart home proposal, AT&T with the M2X development tools and food for the deployment, Orange with the platform Bison Fireware and other managed connectivity. So a lot of people we are working on that because we believe that it makes sense. But we need to build that ecosystem. And if you go to developers, you realize that they are different and they have a classification of 8 types of different developers. We have people that they are here just for fun, hobbies and explorers, and we have people that they want to make money, they want to evolve. The scene is hunters, guns for hire, product standards are optimizers. For us, this is they are the most important or interesting talent to capture out there. The people that want to work and make better products, capture some more value, optimize the processes that we have right now. And of course, data, we have been talking about data, data brokers, people that want to monetize all the data that is being generated. And even a lot of, we have seen a lot of IoT startups that are working and appearing right now. The mix of the different parts of the different classes of talent is evolves as the sector is more mature. If you go in your sectors by maturity, you have industrial, retail, medical, smart cities, connected car, wearables, and smart home, and you realize that the mix of people working on that is different. We feel that the top part, industrial, retail, medical, and smart cities, is more about professional and small, medium enterprises, like with a proposal, B2B proposals in the low end. We have that is absolutely okay. If we have recreational approaches, exploration, just to understand how this should evolve. Okay, for the third layer, IoT platform, this is just a recap of that layer. We feel that the trends are the IoT platform and services and all the ecosystem, and the open ecosystem for open innovation with the old talent acquisition. And after that, we have what we call four layer. For the four layer is about data. It's okay, we are going to have a million of devices connected, generating data. We have that connectivity is managed. We have services on top of that. Okay, all the data can feed my analytics layer, can feed me and give me a lot of tons of data. But the funny thing is what to do with them and how to use them. Or we feel that there is a lot of things that are going to happen to put the squeeze on data to get more value on that data. We right now we have good examples on the energy and the retail ecosystem. We are combining them in analytics. We can looking at the consumption, energy consumption in a retail store. We can have an idea of how to optimize and even how to enhance the experience of the end user, the customers, and get more benefits. Everything connected through analytical algorithms and analysis. Okay, IoT analytics, but you have to build it. And you have to build your proposal. Four simple steps to do it. First one, understanding your data, the four Bs. Second one, which kind of data usages I can do with that big data. What kind of needs can I resolve for myself and for my customers? And based on this input parameters, decide how to formulate my strategy. Four Bs is easy. We have a lot. I have to analyze, okay, my data. Which volumes I'm getting, how variability I have in this kind of volume I'm getting of data, different sources, I have a variety of different sources of data, and which velocity I have to, I'm reaching, I'm receiving, I'm getting that data. What kind of bit that, how can I use it? If you go to, in this scale about difficulty and value, you start with the first two, descriptive and diagnostic, is things that they are happening right now. It's like telemetry and telecontrol. It's like about, okay, what happened? Why did it happen? It's something that we can do it right now. We have a lot of simple examples for a few years. Now we are working in, we all are working in the scenario B and what will happen, being predicting, being able to have the insight to know what is going to happen. And the third one, the most valuable and the most difficult one is to have the capability to press of prescription. Okay, what to do to make that happen? What to do to make this parameter go up or go down or stop down? And okay, questions that I can answer for me and for my clients. How can use this data to enhance my processes? How can I build new value for my customers? Maybe this all this data can be monetized. Well, there are three levels of strategies for and they are not exclusive for the big data usage. One of them is okay for myself, insights about my business to make my processes more efficient. Second one is to build value for my customer, better products for my customers, adding value to them. And finally, maybe this data can be used by a third party to build another service and get money for the data itself. Okay, looking into the future, what's going on? What's happening? We have a lot of activity in the evolution of robotics and the artificial intelligence. We have a lot of activity in new sensor, heuristic sensor, and robots. You have seen there in the fair, we have been a few robots, amazing, that they can do high precision tasks. We are also evolving the artificial intelligence to give a mind, to give a life to these robots, as I was saying in the beginning of my speech. We are talking about expert systems that are evolving and natural interfaces. You can interact with machines not only about a command line, you know. Instead of that, you can use your natural language. And we are moving from single functional units of robots doing simple things that they can learn, can do a lot of things. Okay, let's imagine that we can even have a real smart city integration with all the law, all the capabilities in one robot. Okay. One thing that is happening right now, there is a lot of activity also in the chatbots. Chatbots is giving things a life, a way to interact with humans. A lot of companies they are deploying chatbots to interact with us. Another key trend for us is the multimedia of things. It's the ability to analyze in real time a huge amount of data and understand the reality as if it were a human and take decision, an assisted decision. For us, this is very important. Multimedia thing can be something so as funny or as cool as detecting faces. This is the most repeated photo in the world. Or to do things that really matter, like security, surveillance. This kind of thing are happening. The machines can recognize things and can take decisions, or can give us better insights on our customer, how they move, how they interact, how they react to the experience in my stores, and be able to customize the experience and have a more service and more value. connected car. Another thing that is also evolving a lot. The car has become from the machine to get there. You can drive and get there. So no, nothing else. To the machine that can get just stay connected while you are there, or the machine that has evolved so much right now. We have connected cars with a very different driving experience. We are reaching the autonomous car. Okay, yeah. In the mid-50s, people were talking about the autonomous car. This is a long time awaited project, and now it's becoming a reality. It's a reality right now. We have autonomous cars everywhere. But it's not only that we have autonomous car. Okay, we have right now. It's that we are working on giving them new ways of communicating, new ways of talk to other vehicles, to talk to the infrastructure, to talk to the pedestrian, the people around, to talk to the smart grid, and to talk to other devices. So we are making that car not only that, okay, it can be, I can drive myself. It's not only about that. It's that he can be aware in a holistic way of everything that is around and interact in a holistic way with everything that is around. And we are evolving from the autonomous car to an autonomous traffic model with the security, traffic optimization, the experience, and everything is going to happen. Drones, another big word in the bus. We feel that the drones are going to make some use cases and economy evolve as they are enablers of new things to do. We have use cases with drones. They on our stand we have the explanation. We have a drone over there for precision agriculture. We have drones that can fly above a huge field with different cameras, thermographic cameras, and understand where you need more water, where you need more fertilizer. So you don't need to water all your field every time. So you only go to the specific places where it's needed, or you fertilize only when it's needed. And you maximize the crop, and you maximize the use of energy and water and fertilizers. Sorry. We also have environmental services about contamination, CO2 emissions, things like that, and making this world better. And we also have a very important the inspection of infrastructure. This is a very very important use case right now for us. We are, as an operator, we have thousands of towers with equipment in remote places. Or look about the electric. The electric company, they have thousands of towers with high voltage towers in the middle of nothing. Somebody has to review this infrastructure. And right now, it's a high cost to go there with something to make that people go up 80 or 100 meters, surrounded by things like that, thousands of volts. The other day, I saw the data that in the United States, about 15 people die doing this job a year because it's a high risk. So now we are reducing the cost and we are reducing the risk. The data expert can be near the tower, fly a drone, see all the tower around with all the detail, and even with the thermographic cameras and things like that to detect hotspots or detect breaches in the infrastructure. So it's a better job, less cost and less risk. And other technologies that we also have, also think that they are going to be very important is, for example, augmented reality. Okay, we have been evolving from the augmented reality that needs physical markers to the augmented reality with real-time video analysis and live intelligent mix, everything with a new. So as we have been talking, everything is connected. Multimedia things making these devices aware of the reality, detect where a new character can be inserted using physics and everything. Okay, and augmented reality, we are working in including augmented reality as part of our digital worker proposal. Make workers more efficient, to make workers more aware of the real the environment. Make workers be in charge of enabling them with new knowledge, with specialized knowledge that they can have about using this kind of augmented reality devices. This also used in very specialized and vertical, very critical missions, like SpaceX is using this kind of visualization for their sensor in the rockets. this is IoT. Yes, why? Because to be able to have this kind of visualization, you have to sensorize your project, your rocket, and get that data, analyze it, visualize it, and be able to interact with them. That's why we feel that the augmented reality is going to be a big player in the transformation of this IoT vision. And virtual reality, again, another long-awaited thing from the this is from the movie called Brainstorm from the 1981. It's a very funny movie. I like it. So now, finally, it is here. It's here to stay. And we are going to work in immersive scenarios and interact with them as they were physical assets or physical things that we can touch. We are going to have, this is already happening, doctors, surgeons can have a new different point of view of what they are doing with a new perspective, new abilities that using this kind of virtual reality technologies. And of course, again, with the augmented reality SpaceX case, I told you about the immersive collaborative scenario where a few people can share a physical scenario and can interact with things for complex meetings. Okay, I'm almost done. Wrapping up, the key takeaways, things that you should have in your eyes after leaving this room is that the IoT is happening everywhere. It's about life, movement, and interaction in different scenarios. It's happening everywhere. And we are going to reach the internet of, not the internet of things, it's the internet of everything, where everything it includes us, people, persons. It includes us as not mere users of the internet, of the information. We are actual part of it. We affect the rest of the scenario. We move and we interact with them. So we are part of this internet. We want to be the online telco. That's our motto. To be part of your life from the person, home, transport, retail, citizen, etc. And we feel that the IoT is enabling this kind of digital life, this kind of evolution. We are working right now in a lot of the new connectivities, LPWE, cellular evolution, 5G, even satellital. We are working in that data layer, putting the squeezing of the value of the data. We are working on that also. And we are working in the right technology, in the kind of things that we have been talking about, the reality, augmented reality, virtual reality, drones, everything, all the kind of techie stuff that should be around this ecosystem. Ecosystem because we feel that we cannot do this all alone. We need to build a magnet ecosystem. We want to give value and to receive value. We want to have partners and customers build a whole ecosystem of collaboration. Because in this picture, it's not only that the big magnet is attracting the small iron pieces. The small iron pieces, they are also attracting the big magnet. So that's why we are talking about open innovation, open ecosystem, opening up our platforms or tools to capture talent and value out there. So that's all. You have any comments, questions? We have 10 minutes left, so feel free. Okay, if not, thank you very much. I'm more than pleased to be here. And remember, I'll be back. Hasta la vista, baby.